Deeper learning is something that I really, really enjoy connecting into the curriculum. I feel like it's the opportunity, especially as a math teacher, for students to see, why does this connect to my life? What can I do with this skill when I leave this classroom? Today's lesson was designed for students to order dinner with a friend. Their goal was to plan a complete meal, but as they're doing that, budgeting their money appropriately. So being mindful of unexpected fees and costs like taxes, delivery, tip. We're focusing in on solving all operations with decimals. They were working on rounding decimals to the thousands place. They were comparing values. They were also using estimation as a way to assess if answers are reasonable and breaking apart different word problems, identifying the operations needed, and then creating a plan for solving and solving. And of course, our main takeaway is always being able to discuss with others and build on one another's ideas and thoughts.
Our agenda for this work, okay? You're gonna start off with your entrance ticket, which will be a 3-2-1 model, 3 minutes to solve on our own independently, 2 minutes to discuss as a group, and then we'll have 1 minute to reflect as needed to update our response, modify it, expand, extend, and then you're gonna plan dinner with a friend. So that partner I matched you up with, that's who you're gonna be doing this work with. So you'll be planning dinner with them. You'll have a total of ideally 40 minutes, 35 to 40 minutes to work on that together and plan your dinner while staying in a budget, okay? And then finally, we'll do our exit ticket with another 3-2-1 model. Anybody have any questions about our agenda?
I like the way that you're identifying the different parts of your word problem. That's a nice job.
What am I doing with it?
Circling.
Anything else? Kaylani?
But right now what I'd like you guys to do is take 2 minutes to talk with your group members and share your thinking with one another.
So you need to do an underestimate so like you have enough to tip and do the test. So who wants to go next?
So I do not agree because when it comes to money, you always need to round down because if you round up, you might not have enough money for the items you bought.
So the whole time I have $50 to spend. Isn't $49.99 under $50?
Yes.
It is. But what did she do wrong?
She overestimated.
She overestimated the $46.50.
Oh, so if I needed $3.49, what does that mean for this scenario? About my assumption on...
You didn't have enough money.
Because you rounded it high, you should have done an underestimate.
So what does it mean when you rounded high? What is that called?
Like an overestimate.
Oh, so I made an overestimate. And what could I have done differently, maybe? I haven't heard anybody share that. Anybody have any ideas?
You could have estimated more lower.
So I could have estimated lower?
Yeah.
What do you guys think? What could I have done? Do you agree? Do you disagree?
I agree. Because it's good to underestimate with money because of taxes.
Oh, it's good to, did you say underestimate?
Yes.
Because of taxes. Why might that be helpful? So I want you guys to think about that for a second while I check in with another group. What I'd like you to do is I'd like you to take one moment to just, in the reflection section, you guys can add on to your response if you'd like to modify it, adjust it, maybe extend. A lot of people had really great ideas. If you want to be specific about maybe a mistake I did make, or maybe what I could have done differently, that would be a great time to do that. So you guys can do that in your reflection section now. All right, so Miss Powers went shopping. As we know, I love to shop, okay? I had $46.50 that could be used to buy items. As I walked around, I kept telling myself that I had about $50 to spend, okay? I bought a sweater for $29.99 and a blanket for $20. I assumed I would have enough since I had about $50, right? Was my assumption correct that I would have enough money? Please explain why you agree or disagree with your thought process. Would anybody like to share their thinking or maybe what their group discussed about the answer to this question? Was my assumption correct? What do we think? Hafsa?
Our group thought it was wrong. Because if you overestimate 46.50, you might not have enough. But if you underestimate, you could have enough for the taxes and you would have to tip.
Mm. Did anybody have a different idea or maybe a similar idea and explained it differently or had different thoughts they wanted to add on to that? Chris, what were you guys thinking over there?
You would need $3.49.
I would need $3.49. So what does that mean if I need $3.49?
You would need that to get all of the money to buy everything, but you would need maybe an extra $2 because of the tips and taxes.
Oh, taxes and tips. Look at that. So if I need $3.49, what does that mean about my current situation, Mia?
You can go into debt. Because you don't have enough money.
I could go into debt, which is a sixth grade concept. I love that we're already thinking about that, right? I could go into debt if I'm spending more than what I have. All right, here is your activity. You guys are going to plan a dinner with a friend. You're going to order dinner, all right? And you guys are going to have to plan accordingly in terms of following within a budget, all right? And you also have to worry about things that adults have to worry about, like some unexpected fees or costs potentially. So we want to be mindful of that as we go through this work. Why did you estimate here? What in there was popping out to you to me? It's at about? Excellent. Now let me ask you, Harmony, you are cruising over there, my friend. I love to see it. You guys selected one. Did you both select 120? Why did you choose 120 as your estimated budget?
We chose 120 as our estimated budget because we could get taxed and also we could tip the waiter.
Okay. So how does 120 allow you to do that?
Because we could get a tax of $1 and tip the waiter $2.
Oh. So by selecting 120 as your estimated budget, what it has allowed you guys to do in terms of the money that you guys have?
It allows us to spend more.
So maybe spend more? Okay. And underestimate specifically, how does that help you when you think about a budget?
It helps you by making sure that you have enough money before you start buying.
Oh, excellent. All right. How much money do you guys have roughly to spend?
$123.45.
So is that your exact budget or is that an estimated value?
Exact.
Exact. Okay. So in that first box, what is it asking us to do, Daryl?
It's asking us how much money do you have to spend on dinner together?
Okay. What is it looking for us to do in that box?
Round.
Maybe round? Okay.
Because this is about how much.
So what in there is popping out to you that you have to round?
About.
Okay. I want you guys to think about that. Think about your budget. So what are you doing with those values? You're adding them? Okay. Are they the same values or are they different values?
We have to look at that.
So when we're combining different values, the operation we would use would be addition? Awesome. What if you guys had selected the same item? What operation could I have used? Does that make sense to you? Why could I have used multiplication?
You got tacos, right? Original?
What do you think?
Original?
Because they're the same cost? Okay. And why does multiplication work?
Yeah.
It's faster for what?
When mango sauce, chocolate syrup, caramel.
For what operation?
Folded Mexican pancakes.
So if we're repeatedly adding something, we can use multiplication instead. Awesome. All right, keep it up, guys. All right, guys. I like it because what do you think we should do if we have two different answers? What should we do here, friends?
Why are you adding?
Are we moving on to the next question?
Because you're supposed to know.
No. So what do we think we should do?
Let's see what did you do?
Let's take a look at what we did. I like that, Michael. Let's take a look. So this is a very complex problem. Would you agree? Okay. I want you guys to read through that problem, and I want you to try to box some of the words that are signal words. And a signal word to me, as we know, is something that signals an action that I'm going to have to take. So read through there and box any signal words you see, and we're going to break apart this so we can solve. All right.
I think the questions that we use, the essential understandings that we're trying to focus in on for students, allows for them to have a deeper discussion on topics rather than a singular answer. It allows them to hold a conversation about their individual thoughts and ideas and continue to build on one another.
Product, right? Absolutely. What is a product? Why would that be significant?
It's the answer to multiplication.
So what am I going to have to do as part of this problem at least?
Multiply.
So right now what I want you guys to do is circle what it's looking for as a product, right?
Students don't necessarily need a scaffold throughout the entire activity or lesson. However, there may be moments where they need that scaffold. Becoming independent learners, thinking about what is a scaffold or support that I need in this moment? And then they have the access to go and get that as a support, as needed, for example, with multiplication charts or place value charts or the different flow maps we have throughout that support with understanding different concepts that they might need in a moment but necessarily don't need throughout an entire lesson. What else does it say in that problem? Is that it? Do I just find the product
for
that?
Round the value to the nearest thousandths place.
So round the value to the nearest thousandths place. And remember, if we need support with rounding, right, we have our flow map over there that has that support for us if we need it. But also it's saying round it to the which place value. Okay. Now looking at that value, which digit is in your thousandths place?
The two.
The two. Okay. So what should I do if I want to round it? How do we go about rounding?
How are we going?
I'm not... Jaden, what are you thinking?
Place value to the right.
Okay, so I look at the next place value to the right. And what is that digit in the place value to the right of my rounding digit?
It's adding all the first answers.
Yeah.
So why don't you guys write it? You guys here, write it right on your desk. Write the number. Write the decimal.
12.30.
You rock, never change. There you go. Awesome. Oh, oh. Excellent. So can you underline the rounding digit for me? It looks like you already got there. Can you write the original decimal for me, Jaden?
Rounding digit?
Yep. I want to know what the round. So it's at, wanted us to round to the nearest which place value? Awesome. So I want us to underline that rounding digit in our original decimal. So the original decimal that was presented to us, right, Jaden? Awesome. Excellent. So now what number do I look to help me with my rounding digit to figure out what I do in the scenario? Ah.
For what?
Okay.
For like the subtotal.
What's your rounding digit, Jaden? Awesome. Why don't we underline that, right? We can check right up there in our flow map, and it's there for us too as a support. All right. And now which digit am I going to look to, Jaden, to help me with my rounding? Mm-hmm. About 1 minute, friends. Yep. And what is the digit to the right of my rounding digit telling me to do? What do I do with my rounding digit? I'm going to round up. Absolutely. So what will this decimal become when I round it to the nearest thousand? Okay. Michael, do you agree with him? Is there another way I could write that decimal?
0.625. Rounding it.
Excellent.
If I order a taco, am I just giving $2.85 and walking away? No, what are some of the things that I have to plan for now that we go out to eat? Mia, with a nice quiet hand?
Might have to overestimate what it is because you need to look for the taxes.
Already thinking about it, right? So now when we start going out to eat, we're going to have to start looking at these food items and really thinking about it as an overestimated value because guess what, kids? Welcome to adulthood. Now you guys got to start being mindful of taxes.
And sometimes you also leave tips too.
Yes, and also we want to be mindful of leaving a tip for somebody, okay? That's awesome. I'm glad that we're being aware of those things. Michael?
Also, I think that I don't know if it's true, but my dad said that in New Hampshire, nobody pays taxes.
Oh, that's actually a great point. Somebody brought that up in the other class. So in New Hampshire, in some states, they don't have things called sales tax. There are different types of taxes, right? We have sales tax, real estate tax, and there's other types of taxes as well. And during humanities, we're going to learn about the taxes that we do pay, right? Because even though you're like, oh, man, I got to pay taxes on top of this, right? It's important that we pay taxes. And in humanities, you guys will learn about, well, what are those taxes going towards, right? Why do we pay taxes, and how are they benefiting us within our community? Sound cool?
Yes.
So even though it's frustrating to solve, Michael and Jaden, I'm sorry. It is helpful, I promise, okay? All right, we are going to wrap up with our exit ticket. And remember, we're going to come back to those original ideas here of when budgeting money, why could estimating be important? Awesome. And one of my favorite words are in two of those questions. Explain. Why do we think place value is important when we're dealing with money or we're thinking of money? Why is place value important?
I think it's important because say like you're like grown up, you're like 18, and you went out to buy something nice, and like when you look at the cost, it's like decimals.
Mm-hmm.
So if you use that to estimate, it can help you see if you need to round up or down and to make sure if you still have enough for the taxes and the tips.
Okay, very cool. Anybody want to respond or share their thinking? Go ahead.
It's also that if you mess up, if you like misplace the place value, it could really mess up how much money you it actually costs or how much you actually have.
Can you, that's a great point. Can you give me an example like of
$40.25?
Yep.
You can actually mistake it for
for yourself to have $402 and five cents.
So if I wasn't aware of place value, it seems like the value of money I might have would be different?
Yeah.
Oh, why would that be potentially dangerous when you're thinking about money?
Because if you actually buy something over your budget, it's you're gonna go in debt and you can't buy it.
Yes, that's very true. We want to avoid debt at all costs. Go ahead, Michael. Add on.
So,
all right, friends, I have to wrap up your thoughts and then we're gonna come together. Mia?
Place value is important because if you have $10 and you're getting paid $8 and the 8 is in the tens place, it's gonna count as $80 and then you're gonna get mixed up and not know how much money you have.
Absolutely right. If numbers are in the wrong place value, we mistake them for the wrong value. All right, so next steps with these skills, all right? We will do a field trip in the near future where we are gonna be responsible for budgeting and shopping and planning on purchasing household necessities. Yes, and I love that for us, okay? So you guys are gonna have to use your financial literacy skills and your budgeting skills in terms of how do we shop for household necessities, okay, appropriately. We'll also be able to connect this with fractions, as that's our upcoming skill. And we're also gonna be previewing some of our sixth grade skills, which I've already heard we're talking about. But we'll start talking about unit rates as well as percentages. So I'm excited for those next steps. So today's task really sets students up for being successful with continuing to break apart word problems and creating a plan for solving. It also helped them with thinking about strategies for determining if answers are reasonable or ways to check their thinking. It also set them up for success in terms of our work that's coming up with fractions. So being able to transfer our knowledge with decimals over to fractions is going to be very helpful.